Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Swami Vivekananda Culture Center, the culture arm of the High Commission of India, Colombo, Sri Lanka, I welcome you all to our today's special lecture titled Buddhist Principles of Equality and Social Justice in Indian Constitution to commemorate the Constitution Day of India. To deliver this lecture, we have with us today Professor Dr. Bimlendra Kumar Ji, the head of the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies, Banaras Hindu University, India. Professor Bimlendra Kumar Ji is an eminent scholar who has published a number of scholarly books and articles and other academic research works in various national and international magazines and with publishers and journals. Also, he has presented a number of research papers in a range of international and national seminars and conferences. He is a scholar of an international repute, and it is an honor and a privilege to have you, sir, with us on this special day to celebrate the Constitution Day of India. Friends, the Constitution Day, also known as the Samvidhan Divas, is celebrated in India on 26 November every year to commemorate the adoption of the Indian Constitution. On 26 November 1949, the Constituent Assembly of India adopted the Indian Constitution, and the Constitution came into effect on 26 January 1950. In 2015, the Government of India declared 26 November as the Constitution Day. On this special occasion, I now kindly invite Honorable Professor Bimlendra Kumar Ji, the head of the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies, BHU, to deliver his lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Revanth Vikram Singh Ji, Director Swami Vivekananda Indian Cultural Center, Colombo. So indeed, it is a great matter of honor and pride for me to speak on this Constitution Day of India. So first of all, I am very much thankful to Director Dr. Revanth Vikram Singh Ji for giving me an opportunity to speak on this Constitution Day. As we are very much aware that today we are going to celebrate Constitution Day. On this very day, 26th November 1949, Government of India adopted and enacted the Constitution of India. As we know that our Constitution of India is the largest constitution of the world, there are more than 319 articles, 22 parts, and 12 articles also. So this is considered as the longest constitution of the world. So we are going to discuss the basic principles and Constitution of India related with the equality and social justice. These are the two aspects which I am going to discuss with you, that how our Constitution of India discusses all these things, equality, fraternity, liberty, and universal brotherhood. So how our Constitution of India has adopted all these basic principles of the Buddhism, which has our roots in the Indian culture. So we'll discuss that how we are very much aware that Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who was the chairman of this drafting committee of Indian Constitution, and he says that I have adopted most of the things which have our roots in Indian Buddhism. And we'll see that how in Constitution of India, how some of the articles related with our fundamental rights, they have been adopted from our Buddhist principles. So we'll see, first of all, that if you go through the essence of constitution of India, then we have to go through the preamble of our constitution of India. If you go through the preamble of constitution of India, you will see that how the preamble of constitution of India has discussed the whole our Indian culture and how the roots of all these basic principles, these are available our in our Buddhist Pali text also. So we'll see each and everything in a very brief manner that how some of the aspects related with the equality, fraternity, and social justice, how they have been taken from our Pali suttas available in Dikhnikaya, Majjhima Nikaya, Sanyukta Nikaya, and Anguttara Nikaya. So let us discuss first of all that what is the preamble of our Constitution of India. Then we will discuss some of the aspects related with our fundamental rights. Then we will see that how fundamental of rights are also discussing the roots of our basic Buddhist principles available in our Pali text. So see, the Constitution of India, if you have gone through, then you will remember that we the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic and republic, and to secure to all its citizens in justice, social, economic and political liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship, and equality of status and opportunity, and to promote among them all. Then fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation. So these are the main aspects of which have taken in our preamble of Constitution of India. So if you see the essence of our Constitution of India are available in our preamble. So if you see, there are four or five aspects when we say that we the people of Republic of India having solemnly resolved to constitute sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic and republic. These are also as available in our Pali text also. And it also says that how to secure to all its citizens, that is the justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity. So these are the four aspects which have been taken from our Buddhist Pali text. So we will see each and everything that how they are discussing all these things. So see, first of all, for sovereign, we are also aware that the Lord Buddha was very much democratic and he was in favor of republic. And he was saying that the nation who is being elected by the people, that is the best democratic country. And socialist, Buddha is also called as one of the social thinkers. And even Swami Vivekananda, who was the first Indian thinker, who said that we find a unique element available in our Buddhist text, that is called as a socialistic element, that was the social element. Again, later P.L. Narasu, he was also saying that Buddhist philosophy is nothing but it is a socialist philosophy. Again, P.L. Narasu and others, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who was very much impressed by the book Essence of Buddhism written by P.L. Narasu, he also says that the teachings of the Buddha, and he says that my philosophy relates to the social philosophy, and I am not a student of politics or political science, but I am a scholar of social philosophy. And then he says that my social philosophy is related with only justice, liberty, and equality. These are the three terms Dr. B.R. Ambedkar writes about this. our one of the revival of modern India, that is in for Buddhism, that Anagarika Dharmapada, he also says that Buddha was the first thinker who spoke about the social elements. And he, Anagarika Dharmapada, was the first person who spoke on the global arena that Buddha was a social philosopher and there are social elements available in our philosophy. So here, the socialist, the term which has been taken in our Constitution of India, that is very much available in our Pali text also. And another thing is secular. The term secular, Buddha also says that respect to all religions. In Mahaparinibbana Sutta, there is a discussion about the Sata Aparihaniya Dhamma. And after the Sata Aparihaniya Dhamma, Buddha says that respect to all the religions. Out of the seven Sata Aparihaniya Dhamma, that following these seven basic principles, a nation cannot fall away or cannot down fall away. So he says that out of the seven, there is one that respect to other religions also, respect to other chetyas, temples or monasteries also. So here the secular term, which has been also available in our Pali text, Mahaparinibbana, Dekhnikaya, Mahaparinibbana Sutta also. Democratic Buddha was democratic and in all the places he talks about the democratic nature or republic nature of our Vaisali, Ganraj, we are very much aware. And he, Sata Parhaniya Dhamma, he has discussed about the democratic and republic nature of that Vaisali Ganraj. And he has praised that as long as the Vaisali follows the Sata Parhaniya Dhamma, the state or the country cannot fall away. So the democratic and republic and the country which is being elected by the persons, that is called as democratic in nature. So these two terms are also available in all those texts. So we'll discuss all the here. Again, the preamble says that, and to secure to all the citizens justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity. There are four terms. We'll discuss one by one that how these have been also exposed or have been given exposition in our Pali text also. So justice here in preamble, it says that justice related with the social, economic, and political. As we are very much aware that Buddha says that all persons are equal. No one is inferior. And Buddha says that chattaro banna samsama hunti. And whosoever sees that anyone is superior or anyone is inferior, he is associated with false views. Papakam ditthi gatam. So Buddha says that all persons, and we are very much aware that at the time of the Buddha, there were four castes, and there were four types of varnas also: Brahman, Kshatriyas, Vaisya, and Sudras. But in some of the Pali suttas, we are also having the order of the four persons like Kshatriyas, Brahmanas, Vaisyas, and Sudras. But Buddha, in place of these, also says that there are fourfold of assembly. They are known as Brahman Parisa, Bhikkhu Parisa, Bhikkhuni Parisa, Upasak Parisa, and Upasika Parisa. That assembly of the Bhikkhus, assembly of the Bhikkhunis, assembly of the Upasakas, and assembly of the Upasikas. So these were the fourfold persons or assembly which are available in our Pali text. But we are also having the references of Ath Mahaparisa also in Mahaparinibbana Sutta. And in some of the suttas also, we also find there are eight assemblies available in that. So Buddha says that a person who is not superior or inferior only by taking birth in higher caste, or one is inferior by taking birth in lower caste. So Buddha says that a person who is superior only by the actions, or one who is inferior only through by the actions also. That is why Buddha says that na jaccha hoti vaslo, na jaccha hoti brahmano, kambuna hoti brahmano, kambuna hoti vaslo. So by the actions a person is considered as a superior, or by actions a person is called as inferior. So in that way we are seeing that how in preamble Buddha says about the social, about that. And for economic, Buddha also says that Buddha, a royal king, must follow the 10 royal dhammas, das raj dhamma. And these 10 raj dhammas are dan, chag, dhiti, upekha. So there are some of the, you can say, royal duties which are assigned to a royal king. And by following these, a country can prosper related with the economy of the country or the nation. So again, Buddha, in the some of the text or Pali Suttas, we are also aware that Buddha talks about the Dhamma, that Dhamma is a righteousness. So righteousness is the more main factor for the development of our economy of any country or any nation also. So here in some of the suttas, we are also aware that how Buddha talks about that, how a royal king or a chief of a nation or a country should follow the righteousness. And in some of the suttas, this dhamma or righteousness is equated with the term of morality, or seal, or you can say ethics. So in that way, a nation who is associated with the morality or righteousness, he can prosper, or a nation can prosper in very dimensions. And related with the political, we are having Kut Dant Sut, Agnya Sut, in which there are the duties of a royal king which have been discussed in that. And in Chakvarti Mahasihanad Sutta, Chakvarti Sutta and Mahasihanad Sutta also, we are having the references that how a royal king or a chief of the nation can do for the benefit of the many people or many persons also. So in that way, we see that the justice, whatever the, and Dr. Ambedkar, who was the chairman of the drafting committee of all the, you can say, 13 committees of making Constitution of India. So he says that my main philosophy is the social philosophy, and that social philosophy is related with the only justice, equality, and liberty. And these three, Buddha says that, sorry, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar says that much of the things I have taken from the Buddhist text, and he regards Buddha in that way, that at that time also. And our Constitution of India, some of the scholars are of the opinion that Constitution of India has been taken from the French Revolution or other constitution of UK or USA. But it is not like that. Most of the things in our Constitution of India, they are having roots in our Indian culture or Indian text, like available in our Upanishad or Buddhist text also. So this justice, liberty, and equality and fraternity, these four terms are basically available in our Pali text also. And how Dr. B.R. Ambedkar has taken all these aspects in making the Constitution of India, we are seeing. So again, liberty. We are coming to the next term of the preamble. That is the liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. If you see liberty, here there is a concept of free will or free determination or freedom of speech in our Pali text also. So we'll see that how this liberty of thought, expression, and belief, faith, and worship, they are available in our Pali text also. In Kalam Sutta of Digha Nikaya, there is a sutta which discusses about the freedom of expression also. In Kalam, Buddha also addresses to Kalam that whatever you get it from the tradition or from the belief, you do not accept it, but accept it on the basis of investigation and reasoning. And even Buddha says that whatever you come to my teachings also, you first investigate with the logic and the reasoning also. And if you think that it is available in our teachings of the Buddha or Suttas or Vinaya or Abhidhamma, then you take it, otherwise you do not take it. So Buddha talks about the freedom of expression in our Kalam Sutta also. And even in Chulbag, we are having that how two Brahmin converted monks approached to the Buddha, and they requested the Buddha that teachings of the Buddha may be translated or may be converted into Chandas language also. But Buddha did not agree with that, and he says that yo chandaso arupaya apati dukatas, and he says that anujanami bhikkave sakaya niruttya buddhavachanam paryapunitum, that oh monks, I allow you to translate teachings of the Buddha, that is the buddhavachan, in its own mother language or in its own languages of the person concerned. So he was very much, you can say, liberal in that sense of expressions, that it should not be converted in only one language, but it must be translated in all the languages, mother languages, in which people can speak and that. So here the belief and the faith and whatever the worship, there is a Buddha also regards in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta also, Buddha says that there must be equality. No one can be denied for respecting their own religion, faith, custom, and traditions. Even in Satya Aparihaniya Dhamma, there is a sense that you have to respect religion, custom, and traditions of other peoples also. And at the time of the Buddha, we are also having that there were six contemporary teachers like Puran Kassapa, Makhali Gosal, Nikanthanatha Put, Sanjay Balathi Put, and so there were six contemporary thinkers, and all were, you can say, respecting their own religions at that time also. So no one was, you can say, denying of other religions also. So Buddha was in favor of respecting other religions and belief and thought also. So here again, there is a next term. We are coming to the equality. Equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote among them all. This equality, we have seen that Buddha talks about that all persons are equal. No one is inferior or superior. So in that sense, Buddha says that all persons, even Buddha talks about that women are also having the equal intelligentsia as men have. And Buddha talks about, and the Buddha preaches about the intelligentsia of some of the nuns of at that time, like Dhammadinna, Patachara, those who were, you can say, much intelligent than other monks at that time also. So here Buddha talks about, even Buddha says that all the untouchables and other persons who are denied social status, the Buddha also talks about those untouchables, that they are also equals and they must be given equal status in all that. On because of any caste, religion or any faith, a person cannot be denied his status or his opportunity to get any hierarchy among the post of at that time also. So this was the equality. Again, fraternity, we are coming to the next term, that how fraternity, that Buddha talks about unity and integrity of the nations. In the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, if you go to, through the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, you will find that there is a discussion about the Satta Aparihaniya Dhamma. And Buddha was discussing about the Vaisali Gan Rajya, or you can say Republic of Vaisali. Then he talks that Vaisali Republic is following these seven factors related with the not falling away from the any state or any nation. So he talks that people should assemble time to time. People must respect to elders and the other family members of the society also, and the laws and the customs which are coming from the past, they should not be removed, but they should be continued with some modifications and alterations also, but they must be given. And Buddha also talks that the women must be given respect. There must be assurance that the integrity of the woman, or women cannot be, must not be robbed, or they cannot be cheated, or they their dignity must cannot be denied. So Buddha talks that if a nation or a country follows that women are being respected in the state, the nations cannot fall away. And the next Buddha says about the a person who gives the respect to all the religions, satyas, monasteries and other things or other beliefs, out of the satta parihaniya dhamma, this is also most, and this shows the secular nature of any nation also. And lastly, Buddha says that the persons who are out of the country, but they wish to come to your nation or to the territory of your country, they must be given a place in the country and they must be respected, and their religion and fraternity must be given in that sense also. So in that sense, we see that how Buddha talks in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta about the integrity of the nations as well as unity of the country also. So in that sense, Buddha always talks about the fraternity, that how there must be universal brotherhood. And for that, he has given also four Brahma Viharas, that is the universal friendship, compassion, unalloyed joy, and indifference. So these are the four aspects which have been given for the bringing universal brotherhood, and how through the universal brotherhood we can assure the dignity of the individual, as well as how integrity and the unity of a nation can be assured and protected. So these are which are available in our Constitution of India. These four aspects: justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, which was adopted in Constitution of India. These are having roots our in our Pali text, Buddhist Pali text also. And Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was very much impressed with the social philosophy of the Buddha also. Now we are coming to the second aspect of, you can say, some of the fundamental rights. If you go through the fundamental rights, you will also, I will discuss some of the fundamental rights, not all, because there are from 12 articles to 35 articles which are discussing about the fundamental rights of the people of the India. So I will discuss that how some of the fundamental rights, they are having roots in our Pali text also. So in some of the, if you go through the article number 14, then you will see that article 14 says that the state shall not deny to any person equality before the law or equal protection of the laws within the territory of India. So here article 14 discusses about the equality of the persons, and it must be assured before the law also. So we see that how Buddha in the Pali Suttas always talks about the equality, and Aslayana Sutta, Madhur Sutta, Chanki Sutta, and there are so many suttas which are discusses about the our equal status also. In Chulbag also we are having that Buddha says that how the all the rivers from different directions, whether it is Ganga, Jamuna, Ashirvati, or Mahi rivers, they flow together and they come to the one ocean that is called as Indian Ocean also. So in that way, Buddha also says that all the caste, whether it is Brahman, Kshatriyas, Vaisyas, or Sudras, they all are coming to one that is called as our Indian unity or custom traditions. So in that way, Article 14, there is a discussion, and which is a discussion is related with the equality of the persons, and which is having the roots in our Pali text also. If you go through the Article 15, then it is written that the state shall not discriminate any person or citizen on grounds of only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, any of them. So if you see that how Buddha also does not talks about the discrimination of any on the basis of the caste, religion, belief or something like that. So here we see that how this Article 15 of the Fundamental Rights is having also roots in our Pali text also. And even 15, Article 15 also says that no citizen shall on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, any of them be subject to any disability or liability restriction or conditions with regard to access to shops, public restaurants, and other things. So here, article, if you go through the 15, it also discusses that how on the basis of religion, sex, or customs, or you can say place of the birth, no one is denied or no one must not be discriminated. So we are also having this, all these things in our Pali Suttas also. In Majjhim Nikaya or in Dikh Nikaya, we are also having all these things. So again, we are seeing that how all persons must be given the equal status or equal, you can say, opportunity. So if you go through the Article 16, and Article 16 says that no citizen shall on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, descent, place of birth, residence, or any one of them be ineligible for or discriminated against in respect of any employment or office under the state. So here also that for employment, or you can say any office of the state or the nation, no one is being discriminated on the basis of the religion, caste, custom, belief, or place of birth also. So this is the equality, all discusses all about the equality. And Buddha also says that this is the equality which has deep roots in our Pali text also. And that was the unique quality. And Dr. B.R. Ambedkar also says that if a nation does not follow equality of the persons, the nation cannot develop. And for the development of any nation, a country must have the rules related with the equality. And in that way, he had made the Constitution of India, and he has given the emphasis on the equality of the persons. And these ideas I have borrowed from our Pali text also. Again, in the Article 70, it discusses about the untouchability is abolished and its practice in any form is forbidden. So Buddha also does not regard that any own place of the, you can say, untouchables must not be disrespected or something like that. So he says that the untouchables are also equal. They must be given equal status in the society, and they must be given all their rights in the employment and other things also. So this Article 17, if you go through the, you will find that how these fundamental rights, 16 is also related with the untouchables, are having relations with our Pali teachings of the Buddha. If you discuss about the right of freedom, which have been discussed in the Article 19 of Constitution of India, then if you, I just read the Article 19, then you'll find that how Article 9 discusses about the freedom of expression, thought, and ideas, and how these freedom of rights have relation with our teachings of the Buddha available in Pali text also. So I read that 19 article reads that all citizens shall have the right to freedom of speech and expression, to assemble peacefully and without arms, to form association or unions, to move freely throughout the territory of India, to reside and settle in any part of the territory of India. So these are the five, you can say, freedom of right, which have been discussed in Article 19 of our Constitution of India. So first is freedom of speech and expression. So in the Kalam Sutta, we are having that how Buddha addresses to Kalam, that whatever you get it from the tradition or belief, you do not accept it as it is, but with the reasoning, with the logic, with your aptitude, reasoning aptitude or intellectual aptitude, you just investigate it and then you accept it. So here freedom of right, what the Kalam Sutta discusses, and of Digha Nikaya, it has also been adopted in Constitution of India by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Again, if you see the next of this freedom of right of freedom, that to assemble peacefully and without arms. So in the Mahapradibbana Sutta, Satta Aparihaniya Dhamma, if you go through the Satta Aparihaniya Dhamma, the first is Buddha says that you all people of the society must assemble time to time. Buddha says that after 7 days or 15 days or one in a month, people assemble together of all the religion, faith, caste, and others. They discuss with the problems. They can solve their problems by meeting together. And Buddha has given much stress that by coming together, one can resolve their problems also. So people can even in our society also, it is expected that those who are having some communication gap or not having meeting together, they are having some problems also. So by, if you see the Mahapradipana Sutta, and in the first of Satta Aparihaniya Dhamma, then you will see that how the Buddha has already given much importance on the assembly of the persons also. And there is a freedom of expression also to form associations and unions also. So here, if you see that how Buddha talks about that all people must meet together and they solve their problems. So we see that these are having the roots with our Pali text also. Then to move freely throughout the territory of India. And we are aware that how Buddha was traveling from one place to another place for Bhojan Hitai, Bhojan Sukhai, Lokanukampai, Bhojan Arthai. So here he was also talking in that way that any person can move any from anywhere and others. But in some of the Sanskrit text, we find that how Buddha has also traveled thrice to Sri Lanka also. In Lanka Avatara Sutra, we are also having references that Buddha has gone to Sri Lanka thrice for preaching of his Dhamma to the people of Sri Lanka also. So how he was traveling, so we'll see that how in the suttas we are having the references of traveling. So to the next is the reside and settle in any part of India. So this is the that any person can move from any place. So these are some of the things. And lastly, Article 21 says that no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to a procedure established by law. So Buddha also talks about the equality and no persons can be denied or discriminated on the basis of the caste, religion, belief or place of birth or anything. It means that place of birth does not consider for settling of any person at any place also. So these are some of the fundamental rights which are discussing about the things in our Pali text. Now we are coming lastly, because I have taken much time. So just in a few minutes, I will discuss about the how Buddha talks about the social justice. For regarding the social justice, Buddha has given, if you see the how the social justice, which have been depicted in our Pali text. So the whole teachings of the Buddha can be classified under the four headings. That how Buddha has given under the four headings, all the related with the social justice. First, Buddha says that the opening of the gates of the path of purity for the men and women of all the four varnas, and especially to the fourth varna, that is the untouchables, we can say. And Buddha always talks about the chatu varna parisuddhi, that all persons can get a state of eternal bliss, all persons can be purified by development of consciousness or by purifying his consciousness also. And again, in the second aspect, Buddha related with the social justice, he says that there is a making provision for the path of purity for the women also. So Buddha, if you see that how Buddha has always talked about the purity of the women, and Buddha also says that their women kind must be protected, must be preserved, and they can also get a state of eternal bliss or nirvana. They can also get arhatship also. So Buddha has given a path of the, you can say, and he had also made a provision for the getting a state of eternal bliss for the women also. The third aspect related to the social justice, that how Buddha was elevating the status of the stray religious orders. As we are very much aware that at the time of the Buddha, there were six contemporary teachers also. Besides Buddha, there were contemporary teachers like पुरन कश्यप मखली गोसाल संजय बलठी पुत्र पकुत का चायन अदर्स सो दीज आर ऑल्सो स्ट्रगलिंग फॉर देयर एग्जिस्टेंस इन द सोसाइटी सो बुद्ध नेवर डिनाइड द स्ट्रगलिंग ऑफ देयर एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ अदर तीर्थंकराज और अदर थिंकर्स ऑल्सो एंड देवर ऑल्सो बुद्ध वॉज ऑल्सो इन फेवर ऑफ देयर डेवलपमेंट ऑल्सो एंड दे बुद्ध वॉज इन फेवर ऑफ एलिवेटिंग द स्टेटस ऑफ देयर रिलीजियस ऑर्डर्स ऑल्सो एंड द लास्टली रिलेटेड विद द सोशल जस्टिस बुद्ध हैड मेड ए प्रोविजन दैट देयर मस्ट बी रिहेबिलिटेशन ऑफ द एक्स criminals and social discarded and despised persons. So as we know that how Angulimal was given, you can say a status in the Sangha also, and he was a criminal day at that time also. And how other criminals were also given respect and other persons who were in the jail, they were from when they came out from the jail they were taken in their sangha also they were made so Buddha had given a place for the untouchables as well as ex-criminals also the persons who were inmates in the jails also they were residing in the jails so Buddha had also given place for these people also So for social justice, in the Constitution of India also discusses that the untouchables or ex-criminals or others, they must be also given a place. And in the Constitution of India, the government of India has given much importance to these persons also. So we see that how Buddha has also given much importance So you will see that in the Pali Suttas or in Nikayas, how Buddha talks about the rehabilitations of the ex-criminals or socially discarded persons also. Even we know that Upali, who was the barber by profession, but he never allowed about he was the, you can say, follower of Vinay also. And he was the person who was given the responsibility of compiling the Vinay Pitak also. So even a barber who was the low caste, he was given a higher place in the Sangha also for compiling the teachings of the Buddha. So how the low untouchables and the ex-criminals were given a place in the society, in the Sangha, So we see that how our Constitution of India talks about all these articles or the fundamental rights related with the ex-criminals or untouchables or those who have been excommunicated, they have been given a place in our Constitution of India also. So these are some of the things which have been discussed in our Pali text also and Buddha also always talks about the equality of all the persons also and how we have seen that in the Sangha also Buddha does not make any distinctions whether it is Anand or Mahakachan or Upali or other but he has given equal status of all these things and even for Siddhartha's own mother also Mahaprajapati Gautami as well we have seen that how they were given a place in the Sangha it is another thing that initially Buddha was hesitant to take women in the Sangha and he was thinking that it is not prime time for taking women into the Sangha And he was thinking that there will be downfall after 1,000 years of Sadhamma when the woman will be taken into the Sangha. So in that way, but we, if you see the history of Indian Buddhism, we do not see that due to women or Bhikkhuni Sangha, there is a downfall of Indian Buddhism in India also. Buddhism is also flourishing in our country also. So these are some of the aspects, and even liberty, fraternity, if you see that how in fraternity Buddha talks about all the freedom of expressions and religion, that no one on the basis of religion, caste or faith be discriminated for anything like that. So these are some of the things which I have discussed in our related with the social justice, related with the our Constitution of India, and how we see that in the preamble of India, preamble of Constitution of India, as well as our fundamental rights of our Constitution of India, how they are having deep roots in our Pali text available in the teachings of the Buddha, and how Dr. B.R. Ambedkar always says that I am very much influenced with the social philosophy of the Buddhism. And we see that how Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was influenced with the P.L. Narasu's book, Essence of the Buddhism. And if you go through the Essence of Buddhism in the preface and in the introduction, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar has also written preface of that book, and how he admits that how I have been influenced with the this book, Essence of Buddhism of P.L. Narasu. So with these words, I thank Dr. Revanth Bikram Singh for giving me an opportunity to share some of the views related with the basic principles of Buddhism, related with the equality, social justice in our Indian Buddhism. So I am very much thankful to the Swami Vivekananda Indian Cultural Center, Colombo, for giving me an opportunity on this Constitution Day. This is the day which on which our Constitution of India was enacted, adopted, and implemented. So thank you very much. With these remarks, thank you very much for patience hearing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, Professor Bimlenji, for gracing this occasion and sharing your enlightening thoughts with us. Sir, as highlighted by you, we can see several aspects of Buddhist principles in our Indian constitution. The Buddhist symbols are also incorporated in our national symbols, such as in our national emblem and national flag. I am sure our audiences, both through this platform as well as through social media platform where we are streaming your lecture live, would have immensely benefited from your enlightening lecture, sir. Thank you so much again for the same, sir.
Thank you very much. With see this, you again.
sir. Yes. With this, we end our today's program.
Yes.
May all be happy, healthy, and blessed. Jai Hind.
Thank you very much. Sabbe satta bhavantu sukhitanta arogino khamino hantu. Let be, all beings be happy. Thank you very much. And we must respect our Constitution of India, which have been enacted and adopted on this very day. And we must take an oath to implement all these ideals which are available in Constitution of India. We must follow all these articles and fundamental rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.